And now it's time for the Everlasting Gospel. Welcome to the Everlasting Gospel today. My name is Gary McDade. I'm the speaker for the program, and we're glad you're with us. We're going to be studying today primarily from Matthew 13. Those who watch the program know that we study the Bible here, and I encourage you to get out your Bible and follow along. This program is brought to you by the Churches of Christ in the area and by the Browns Ferry Road Church of Christ, where I'm privileged to be one of the preachers. I'd like to have you come visit with us. All of these Churches of Christ in the area would welcome your visit anytime you can come. Our study today is entitled very simply, The Kingdom of Heaven is the Church of Christ. And our text is Matthew 16, verses 18 through 19. Let's begin by reading that text, because that title right there may be a stumper for somebody, and I don't want that to be the case. I want you to know why we have that title for our lesson theme today. So in Matthew chapter 16, we find that the Apostle Peter had just affirmed his confession of faith that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And then in verses 18 and 19, the Apostle Matthew records Jesus' words where he said, "And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell," or Hades, "shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Two quick points by way of observation. Number one, the rock upon which Jesus said he would build his church is the fact that he's the Son of God. That's what the Apostle Peter just confessed. The second point is that later in Matthew's gospel, he will say to the other apostles, therefore including all of the apostles, this is in chapter 18, in verse 18, "Verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." And the point here, the audience here, is the apostles. So all of the apostles were in a unique position to communicate the will of Christ to the world. Our point in looking at this text is to show that the kingdom of heaven is the Church of Christ. And what we'd like to do in our study today is to notice how the New Testament teaches in that regard. Again, let's get the text out here for sake of emphasis. This is Matthew 16, 18. "And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell," or Hades, "shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Our Lord spoke much about the kingdom of heaven. In fact, when we come to our Bible, we understand that the word kingdom occurs 316 times in the whole Bible. There's a concentration of this discussion in the book of Daniel. For example, in Daniel chapter 2 at verse 37, Daniel will observe concerning Nebuchadnezzar, who was the king of Babylon. He will observe that Nebuchadnezzar was a king of kings, meaning that he's a king of a world empire, which Babylon was at that moment in history. And we will also notice that he will tell him the nature of his kingdom. So since we're talking about a kingdom, let's get in mind what is meant when the word kingdom is used in the Bible. So in Daniel chapter 2, verse 37, here's what Daniel says to Nebuchadnezzar. "Thou, O king, art a king of kings, for the God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom, power, and strength, and glory." Notice the things that go with this kingdom: power, strength, and glory. His being king of kings points to the fact that he was a powerful king. His kingdom was the most dominant empire at that time, from 606 to 536 BC. Now also, since Daniel has several references to the word kingdom, let's notice that in that same chapter, Daniel 2, in verse 44, that Daniel is going to prophesy a coming kingdom years down the road. In fact, he will tell about subsequent world empires, concluding with the Roman Empire, BC 63 to AD 138, where Rome will be in power. And of that time period, Daniel will say, And in the days of these kings, the Roman kings, shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Daniel prophesied an everlasting kingdom to be established in the days of the Roman Empire. Therefore, you have a kingdom, you have power, you have strength, you have glory, all of that connected with that kingdom. Now, later in Daniel 2 and Daniel 7 are parallel texts because the same subject matter is in mind. I'd like you to notice in Daniel 7, in verse 27, that Daniel says, "And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High." You might notice in your Bible that the word high there is capitalized. That's a reference to God. "Whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him." So now we have an earthly king in Nebuchadnezzar and an earthly kingdom, but now Daniel is talking about another kingdom over which God would rule over all the kingdoms of the earth. We know that to be the kingdom of Christ, and as we are emphasizing today, the kingdom of Christ is the church of Christ. Now let me show you what happens when we come over to the New Testament. In the New Testament, John the Baptist begins to prepare the way for Christ by preaching, and it's summarized in one phrase in Matthew 3:8, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." At hand is a metaphor for meaning nearby. When Jesus begins to preach in Matthew 4:17, guess what? He says the same thing. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Jesus was bringing the kingdom into being. Notice also that in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5:3, Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." So the kingdom of heaven is going to be comprised of people who are not arrogant, but who are humble, who are actually poor in spirit. Look down in the Sermon on the Mount to verse 10 of chapter 5, where Jesus will say, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." So now the kingdom of heaven is going to be made up of those people who don't just do right sometime, but they are righteous people. They want to do right all of the time. And as a result of that, they're willing to be persecuted for righteousness' sake. Look down a little further in that same chapter to verses 19 and 20. We find Jesus making the statement that the one who's least in the kingdom of heaven is the one who breaks one of these least commandments. So one is not highly favored who doesn't do what Jesus says. Same verse, he also says, "The one who does and teaches these things, the same is greatest in the kingdom of heaven." Notice this continual reference to the kingdom of heaven. And here, one who's doing what the Lord said to do. Later in the Sermon on the Mount, toward the close of it, Jesus will say in Matthew 7:21, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven." So the kingdom of heaven is not just where someone says something or some statement of a loyalty or an interest, but it is where they actually put into practice the teaching of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now the Lord wanted this teaching continued, for in the limited commission of Matthew 10 verse 7, you'll find that he sent the disciples out. And what was their message? Repent, because the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Men needed to turn away from the ways of the world into which they'd fallen custom, and to now seek Christ and his will. Why? The kingdom of heaven was nearby. It was at hand. In fact, then, as we read on through Matthew's gospel, we see additional references to the kingdom of heaven, such as Matthew 16, verses 18 and 19. Where we learn that the kingdom of heaven is the church of Christ. My church, Jesus said, equals therefore the kingdom of heaven. Now what I'd like for us to do today, if you wouldn't mind, is to notice that our Lord taught in parables. In fact, Jesus Christ is the only great teacher of history who used parables as a means of communication. He uses 40 parables to communicate his will to mankind in the gospel accounts. Today, I'd like for us to take a brief look at seven. I think seven of those parables will fit into the time frame we have allotted for our study. All seven of the parables we'll be studying today come from one chapter of the New Testament, and that is Matthew chapter 13. Now, you may remember that in the Old Testament, it was prophesied that the Savior would speak in parables. That will be in Psalm 78 at verse 2. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old. A parable is an allegory of comparison, by which one truth is laid alongside another truth. The second truth being something familiar from real life. In the parables, there is not an imaginary item being brought up, or a myth, or a fable, but it's something from real life that will describe the first truth, a comparison, a parable to lay alongside for the sake of clarity and understanding. Therefore, a parable is technically an allegory of comparison. And Jesus is the best at that of all time. Any other speaker who's tried to make such comparisons pales into insignificance against our Lord. His teaching becomes crystal clear as he utilizes these 40 parables overall, and as we'll see in the seven that we'll examine today as time affords us opportunity. In fact, within this chapter of Matthew 13, it will be called to our attention that is what Jesus is going to be doing, is speaking in parables. This will be Matthew chapter 13, right in the middle of the chapter, verse 34 and 35, where Matthew records, "All these things spake Jesus unto the multitude in parables, and without a parable spake he not unto them, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables, I will utter things which have been kept secret from the foundation of the world." So Matthew points back to Psalm 78 in verse 2. Now, what Jesus is comparing in Matthew 13 is what the kingdom of heaven is like. There are eight times in the New Testament that the Bible will say the kingdom of heaven is like, and most of those are from the mouth of Jesus. There are five times in this one chapter where Jesus says the kingdom of heaven is like. Now, since we have made the point that the kingdom of heaven is the church of Christ, we could say with equal truth and clarity, the church of Christ is like what we read about here in this passage of Scripture, identified by these seven parables. You see, as members of the Church of Christ, we understand the church by definition from the Bible. And that's where we get our definition and understanding of the Church of Christ is from the Bible. Paul said, "The churches of Christ salute you," Romans 16, 16. So when we want to be this church, members of this church, we want to be what the Lord said we should be. And as we examine these seven parables, we will be challenged in our Christian life to be more like what the Lord wanted us to be, because the kingdom of heaven is like these things. And this gives us a lot to work on in living the Christian life to be what the Lord expects us to be as citizens of His kingdom. Now, I want you to know that there are those who teach that Christ wanted to set up a kingdom, but He didn't get to. And it's coming later, and it'll only be 1,000 years. Just in our reading today, we saw in Daniel 2:44, Daniel 7:27, that this kingdom would be an everlasting kingdom, that it would begin during the days of the Roman Empire. The passages that we read, Matthew 3:8, Matthew 4:17, also Matthew 10:7, where the kingdom of heaven is at hand, shows that Christ understood His kingdom would come into being in the lifetime of the people then living. It's even stated as such in Mark 9, verse 1. "There be some of them which stand here which shall not taste of death till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power." So the kingdom of God did in fact come. And we can read in our New Testament and see in the book of Acts, there are several occurrences, maybe half dozen places, where we find that what the apostles do after the ascension and coronation of Christ as king over His kingdom is they are preaching the kingdom of God. Paul will spend 2 whole years in Rome under house arrest preaching things concerning the kingdom of God, no man forbidding him. So the kingdom was in existence in the first century. And I'm sorry to say that all of my friends who believe the rapture and the thousand-year reign are wrong. And I say that based upon what the Bible says. I want you to believe what the Bible says and not what the premillennialists say. There's some leading characters, some powerful personalities, some institutions that promote that false doctrine, but it takes away from what the Bible says. If we want the kingdom of heaven, which is the church of Christ, we want what the Bible says about it. Now, with that in mind, I'd like for you to notice that the phrase kingdom of heaven is used 33 times by the Apostle Matthew in his gospel. Luke doesn't use the phrase the kingdom of heaven. He uses the phrase the kingdom of God. Guess how many times he uses the phrase kingdom of God? Luke uses the phrase kingdom of God 33 times. Mark uses kingdom of heaven 15 times. They're all referencing the same point, and that is the dominion, the strength, the power, and the glory of Christ over his people in this world. Jesus Christ is seated at the right hand of the majesty on high, angels, principalities, and authorities being made subject unto him right now. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2, 1 Peter 3, 21 and 22, Revelation chapter 3, verse 22. So let's take a look at some of these parables then, as we have time and opportunity. There are seven parables in Matthew 13. Let me just read down through the list. This also goes out over the radio. You have a real advantage if you're watching on TV because it's on the screen. But if you're listening by way of radio, let me read the list of the seven parables that appear in Matthew chapter 13. They are, number one, the parable of the sower. Number two, the parable of the tares. Number three, the parable of the mustard seed. Number four, the parable of leaven. Number five, the parable of the hid treasure. And number six, the parable of the pearl of great price. And number seven, the fish net. These are the seven parables we'd like to study about over the next few moments. Let's begin by taking this first parable and just reading it, and then we can make some quick observations. We won't need a lot of discussion about what they mean because the meaning is clear. The Lord is laying alongside teaching of what the kingdom of heaven is like with something with which they are familiar, like the sower. They had seen men in the field reaching their hand into a bag, grabbing seed, and sowing it in the field, throwing it out so as to spread it out or sow that seed. They knew what he was talking about. Let's see this parable, verse 3 beginning. He spake many things unto them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. And other fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear. When Jesus gives the explanation of this in verses 18 to 23, he will say, Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receives seed by the wayside. But he that receiveth seed into stony places, the same is he that heareth the word, and anon with joy receiveth it. Yet hath he not root in himself, but dureth for a while, for when tribulation or persecution ariseth because of the word, by and by he is offended. He also that receives seed among the thorns is he that heareth the word, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becometh unfruitful. But he that receiveth seed into good ground is he that heareth the word and understandeth it, which also beareth fruit and bringeth forth some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. My observation for you is the one who is the good soil, the good heart that receives the seed, the word of God, Luke 8, 11, will bear fruit in his or her life. If no fruit is being born, that is, if these things are not being put into practice, it tells us the sad condition of our heart. The parable of the sower. Next, he goes to the parable of the tares in verses 24 to 30, And what I'd like to do here in the interest of time is notice that the disciples ask him to declare unto us the parable of the tares of the field. And they will do this, Jesus will do this in his explanation of it in starting in verse 37. In verse 37, he that soweth the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, the good seed are the children of the kingdom, but the tares are the children of the wicked one. The enemy that sowed them is the devil, the harvest is the end of the world, the reapers are the angels. As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity, and shall cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then shall the righteous shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear. So Jesus gave the explanation about a field that had been sown with good seed, but here comes the enemy with the tares. Let them grow up. I'll take care of that at the judgment. And you see his explanation there. The kingdom of heaven is like the sower sowing good seed. The kingdom of heaven is also like the good seed growing up, and there are tares in this field, sown by the devil. And the Lord is going to come back, and all who are in his kingdom that offend will be gathered together, and there will be wailing and gnashing of teeth as they are cast out. Pretty strong teaching. So let's notice next, after we've seen the parable of the tares, the parable of the mustard seed in verses 31 and 32. The mustard seed is described by our Lord as being the smallest of all of the seeds, and it was among the commerce of the Jews. And yet this tiny seed would grow a large bush, so much so that the birds of the air could come and lodge in its branches. The meaning is obvious. The kingdom of heaven may begin with small emphasis and yet grow to large influence. The second one along that same line is the parable of the leaven, which a woman took and hid in 3 measures of meal or of dough. And this leaven leavened the whole lump. The permeability of the Word of God, the kingdom of heaven among men, is that which is emphasized. The Word of God has penetrated into every country on the globe. People around the world have heard about Christ and about His church. There are many Christians throughout this world. This kingdom is like leaven. We want to keep that in mind because we do have an influence when we teach and preach the Word of God. We're moving quickly through this list to the hid treasure in verse 44, where Jesus said, "Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a treasure hid in a field, the which when a man hath found, he hideth, and for joy thereof goeth and selleth all that he hath, and buyeth that field." This shows you that the kingdom of heaven is more valuable than anything you have, in fact, than everything put together. When this man found it, he sold all that he had and he bought that field. You notice when we become Christians, we buy into Christianity and all that it means. We don't go in and try to alter or change that. You'll notice the field was designated by the deed. He bought that field as prescribed. When we become Christians, we have it described for us right here in the Bible. We don't go in and change it in some way. No, we take the whole field. We do everything the Lord wants because we see it more valuable than everything else that we own or possess or hold dear in this life. And similar to that parable is the parable of this pearl of great price mentioned in verses 45 and 46. When a merchant man who was seeking goodly pearls, he found one pearl of great price. He sold all that he had and bought it, showing that everything we've ever done before in our life is worth all of that together. The kingdom of heaven is more valuable than everything we have ever done in life. What a teaching about the kingdom of heaven, the church of Christ, presented in the parable of the pearl of great price. You see, the church is so important to us. It's more important than anything in this world to us. And that is illustrated as our Lord teaches us here in this allegory of comparison, this parable of the pearl of great price. And then finally, in this list of 7, and I've kind of hurried through these, but I think that the teaching is very plain. In verse 47 to 48, there's a man who's a fisherman, and he uses a net, and he casts that net into the sea. And he brings out the fish that he had drawn to shore. He gathered the good into vessels, but he cast the bad away. Jesus tells the meaning of this when he says, "So shall it be at the end of the world. The angels shall come forth and sever the wicked from among the just, and shall cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth." Jesus asked his disciples, "Have you understood all these things?" They said, "Yes, Lord." He said, "Every scribe then that is instructed under the kingdom of heaven is like to a man who's a householder that brings forth out of his treasures things new and old." Jesus concluded his teaching in parables on that occasion. 7 parables telling what the kingdom of heaven or the church of Christ is like. You'll notice, and I'd like you to notice with me, when he said that he's going to gather out of his kingdom all things that offend and them that do iniquity in the second coming, and the angels will do that and gather them together to burn them like weeds out in a field, does cursing offend God? Oh, yes. Our speech is to be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that we ought to know how to answer every man, Colossians 4:6. Does drinking alcohol offend God? Habakkuk 2:15 affirms yes. Does fornication offend God? Matthew 5:32, Jesus condemns it. Does smoking offend God? Certainly it hurts the body. 1 Corinthians 3:16 and 17 shows how offensive it is. Does greediness offend God? Ephesians 5:5 answers in the affirmative. Does forsaking the assembly offend God? Oh yes, it is to sin willfully. Hebrews 10:25 and 26. These 7 parables then, the sower, the tares, the mustard seed, the leaven, the hidden treasure, the pearl of great price, and the fish net, all show us that the kingdom of heaven is the church of Christ and what that is like. Our hope and plea is that we will define in our minds and life what the church is by what the Bible teaches. Now, Jesus made a statement that we have read where he said, "I will build my church," and we see that his church is the kingdom of heaven and he's the one that will build it. Here's how he will do it. Men and women will hear his gospel. Remember Matthew 13? "He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." They will believe that gospel, John 3:16. They will repent of sins, Luke 13:3, and confess Christ as their Savior, Matthew 10:32, and be baptized into Christ for the remission of their sins, Matthew chapter 28:18 through 20, and Acts 2 and verse 38. Jesus said, "Who hath ears to hear, let him hear," Matthew 13, verse 9 and verse 43. Have you ever thought of it? This is the way that the Lord Jesus Christ is building his church, by the teaching of the Bible that men and women obey. And when they obey that teaching, then those people are added by the Lord to the church of Christ, Acts 2 and verse 47. They are referred to in our New Testament as Christians, Acts 11 in verse 26, 1 Peter 4 and verse 16. And with that in mind, that is how Christ is building his church, his kingdom. He has dominion over all of those, power, strength, and glory, who submit to the gospel, obey him, and he adds to his church or his kingdom. Isn't that wonderful teaching to know that the kingdom of heaven is the church of Christ and that it exists among men today and is available to you and me? Thank you for your attention. Please return next time.